This is another installment in our beginner-friendly series featuring the Voxelab Aquila. And today, we are focusing on PID tuning, which means we're talking temperature. And more specifically, in this video, the temperature of our hot end, which is behind this fan shroud. I have one here outside of the fan shroud. Now, our hot end has two components related to the heating system. They are the heating cartridge. This is the component that is responsible for producing the heat in our heating block, which transfers to our nozzle. This is the brawn. It heats, but this isn't doing any computing. For that, we look towards the thermistor. This is what detects and attempts to adjust the temperature within the hot end. And this is our PID controller. So the thermistor is our PID controller, and its purpose is to control the heat in our hot end. But how does it do that? Well, most people are familiar with an on-off style of controller, where when attempting to control the temperature, the system will remain on until the target temperature is reached, and then shut off until the temperature falls below the target again, and the system is once again activated to reach the target temperature. Now, this process can result in large fluctuations. In a PID style controller, it's gaining constant feedback between the current temperature and the target temperature, and attempts to correct the deviation between the two. Let's use the cruise control of a car as an example. If a car's cruise control is set to 60 miles an hour, and the car is currently going 55 miles an hour, the on-off style controller would apply acceleration until 60 miles an hour was reached, and then turn off. Of course, the car would continue going forward until drag or whatever outside forces caused it to slow down below 60 miles an hour, and then the controller would once again turn back on and accelerate, which is really not a great way to maintain a particular speed. In a PID system, the controller is getting constant feedback between the target speed and the current speed, and it's attempting to correct the deviation between the two, which results in a more stable system. So if our controller, the thermistor, is constantly making adjustments to stabilize our temperature, why do we have to tune it? Well, what we are doing when we tune it is make it more responsive and thus more accurate near a particular temperature. So it will reduce the deviation around that temperature, and only minimum correction will be needed. In our case, we're going to choose a temperature that is our common printing temperature. For me, I'm going to choose 205 degrees Celsius. It's where most of my PLA Plus filaments print, and I'm going to tune my thermistor to that temperature. So in plain English, what is our goal with PID tuning? To have our printer keep a more stable temperature while printing. Now, the type of issues you might see that could benefit from tuning your PID are banding or inconsistent layer thickness. Maybe you notice on your LCD screen during prints that the temperature is varying wildly. Or you could see no deformities at all, you just want to calibrate your printer. Now, we know a little bit about the process. How do we go about actually tuning it? Well, tuning is done completely through our printer's terminal. And in order to access that, we need to connect to the printer through USB, micro USB actually, using a computer or a Raspberry Pi via Octoprint. Today's video, we will describe the process using a computer to access the terminal. Okay, in this next step, we need to be able to talk to our printer. And in order to do that, we need to access the terminal. There's a few different ways to do that. This is nothing we can do from our LCD screen. We have to jump onto a computer and do this. A few different ways we can do it. One is through our slicer cura. We can send it G-code commands in the terminal, but unfortunately we don't get an output, which is really important. Secondly, we can use Octoprint, which I prefer. I know there is a barrier to entry with Octoprint though. You have to have a Raspberry Pi, another SD card, download it, install it, get it up and running. So while I prefer that, I haven't put a video out on that yet, so I'm not gonna use that method. And finally, you can use Pronterface, which is basically downloadable. You hook up your printer via USB, and then you can access the terminal, and you can do exactly what we're about to do. So I'll walk you very quickly through how to download it. Go to the Pronterface website, click the download option, brings you to this menu down here, click latest release, scroll all the way down to whatever your application is, Mac or Windows. I'm gonna click Windows 64-bit, actually. Cancel that, make sure I bring it into the proper folder. I added a folder to my desktop just for this. So it's pretty simple. You download the zip. Here it is in the folder. I'm going to extract it from our zip. I'm using WinRAR to do that. After that, you'll see the application. Pretty simple. We want to make sure you are plugged in to your printer at this point via USB. And before we open this up, we're going to make sure the baud rate is correct. So for Windows users, you're going to type in the search. You're going to look for Device Manager. Click on that. Find ports when this opens up. So right down here, ports, double click it. It'll open all the different connections you have. I only have one, so it's very obvious that my port for the printer is going to be COM3. If you have several things plugged in, you might have a few different comms here. If you need to differentiate what your printer is, you can unplug your printer, come back into the ports, see what isn't there, then plug your printer back in, see what is added, and that is the printer port. Before we move on from here, you're just going to right-click, choose Properties, and we're going to set our baud rate. So the standard baud rate out when I first plugged in was actually 9600, but in order to connect the best way possible, the only way I found in Pronterface was to select 115-200. So select that, hit OK, close Device Manager out, and we can open up Pronterface. I'm not going to go over an exact setup of Pronterface. All we want to do is access the terminal. So this is an abridged version, so we can get to the terminal and do our quick PID tuning. So this is the interface of Pronterface. Right up here in the top, we have our ports. We know I only have one, and it is COM3, and then we have the baud rate. So if yours was 9600 and you tried to set it up, most likely you won't be able to connect, but you can try the different baud rates here. But I chose 115-200, and after I do that, I hit connect, and this is the output of the terminal. Everything is right here. Connecting printer is now online. So we've connected to our printer. We can now send G-code commands through our terminal right down here and have it give us information back, and that's how we're going to PID tune. So we're now ready to auto-tune our printer. The first command we're going to send is M503. Hit enter, and you'll see a bunch of settings come up. Now what this is going to give us is our current PID numbers. So right at the bottom of all these different settings, and these are our printer settings here, we're going to find PID settings. Below that, we're going to see a list of numbers. P28.72, I2.62, and D78.81. Those are our current PID numbers. What we want to do is write those down for two reasons. In case something happens, we need to restore those numbers. We have them. And then after we're done auto-tuning, we can compare the two sets of numbers and we can see what kind of variance we have. So after we have those numbers, we can start the auto-tuning. It's very, very simple. This is built into the Marlin firmware. And the command, I'm going to write the whole command out and then I will explain what it is. Okay. So the first command is M303. That will start the auto-tune process. The variables after it, E0, that's selecting our hot end thermistor. So we have two thermistors on this machine. One is on our hot end, one is on our bed. If we wanted to select the bed thermistor, it's -1. And then obviously the first extruder that has this thermistor is 0. So E0, we're going to be tuning up the hot end thermistor. C10. Now C is going to stand for cycles. We're going to auto-tune this 10 times or 10 cycles. The minimum value is 3. The default is 5 if you weren't to put anything here. I recommend 10. It doesn't take long to do this and you get probably a more accurate result over the course of 10 iterations. The last setting there is S205. Now that's the temperature it's going to tune itself around. Now what you're going to want to choose for the temperature is whatever your base temperature is that you normally print at. So I print a lot with PLA Plus and most of my PLA Plus filaments print at 205, almost on the dot. So obviously tuning it to that number for me makes a lot of sense. If you print PLA or different materials that require less temperature, maybe you're printing it around 185, 195, find a nice average and then tune it to that, 190. Now I'm also going to be printing TPU with this, which is going to probably be printing at around 228. So maybe it would be a good idea at that point to tune this to 215, somewhere between my PLA Plus numbers and my TPU numbers. But right now, I can only foresee PLA Plus printing, so we're going to tune this right to around 205. After that, we hit enter, and the auto-tune starts. So now what is happening during this auto-tune is
the printer is heating up the nozzle to the appropriate temperature, in our case 205, and then the thermistor is getting values and adjusting on the fly in order to compensate for those values. And it's going to do that 10 separate times. Okay, the Autotune's finished. It's only taken us 4 minutes to complete that whole process. Once it got up to temperature, it just cycled a few different times. And then after all the auto-tuning was finished, you can see new numbers have appeared here at the bottom. Default, default, default. P, 32.21. I, 3.79. And 68.41. Those are the new recommended PID numbers. So those aren't in, they haven't been introduced to our printer yet, so that's our next command. And it's very simple, just like the other ones. M301, then P, and you're going to copy what the value of P was up here. Now, you're not going to copy mine. It's going to be different for whatever your printer is. Everyone's is going to be different. But you take whatever P was, and you put it right next to it. So mine was 32.21. Then, obviously, you're going to move down. You're going to copy the I. I, for me, it was 3.79. After that, finally, we do D. And my value was 68.41. Hit enter. You can read in the terminal. It sent it with the command, and then it showed you what the new values are going to be. 32.21, 3.79, 68.41. Now, in order to check that those values have taken and are in your printer, we're going to run the same code we ran at the beginning of the tutorial, which is M503, and we're going to see if those current values are in our printer. So previously, when we M503, we saw the initial values were P28.72, I2.62, D78.81. We come down to settings here, and we see the process has taken. P32.21, I3.79, D68.41. So that means we've auto-tuned our PID, we got the proper numbers, and we were able to add them to the printer. So now currently our printer has the same numbers that the auto-tune told us were sufficient. Now, we need to do one more thing, which is what we did in our E-step calibration video. We need to save this to our EE prompt. So the command for that, just like it was in the last video, M500, hit enter. And after we hit enter, we're saved.
Once you enter the M500 command, your settings are saved and you are done. You can pat yourself on the back now. Now hopefully, after doing this process, you get a more constant temperature while printing, which should result in more accurate and better looking prints. Now, if you learned something from this video or felt entertained in any way, please like it. I am finishing up a dual gear extruder video that takes aim at flexible filaments that's set to release next week. So if you subscribe now, you'll get notified when it comes out. If you have a topic you want to see me explore or anything in this video that wasn't clear, please leave a comment below. I'm going to leave all the G-code commands in the information section underneath this video. And of course, until next time, as always, keep on printing.